A misfit here, because all of you are talking of how we must improve, and here I am talking of what we've not done right. But I think unless we understand that there is a problem that exists in the way we invest in education or invest in our own people, there is far less solutions that we can find. And my job for the past few years has been to go about talking to policymakers, government, administrators, even educationists for that matter, to raise their voice so that we as a country can invest more in our own human resources. So the challenge that we always think is that, you know, we think that every politician, if you think of every administrator, every policymaker, when you talk to them, they say, listen, India is blessed with demographic dividend. What does it mean? That just because we are the most populous country, we're going to reap the dividend? Is it possible that you can actually earn a dividend without investments? And this is a question that, you know, for them, you know, it's a no-brainer for them, because they think that the way we are structured as a populous country and the way we are structured in terms of a young nation, we deserve by right to reap that dividend. So here is what the UN Population Fund defines. The demographic dividend is the economic growth potential that can result from shifts in a population age structure, mainly when the share of the working age population is between 15 and 64. So any population that is between 15 and 64, you typically are supposed to reap a dividend. And even the Prime Minister of India has said that India is blessed with demographic dividend and demand. Having said that, these are three big questions that I always ask people. First of all, are the 65%, because India has 65% people between this age group of 15 and 64, are the 65% people in the productive age group of 15 to 64, are they first of all employable? If they're unemployable, have we done anything in terms of investments to make them employable? And assuming they're employable, have we done enough to create jobs for them so that they can the dividend that we claim to own is actually reaped? The thing that we fail to understand is that India is this population, that 15 to 64 and 65%, has not happened because India planned for it. It happened because we have a great amount of apathy towards women and child welfare. It just happened because we did not bother about the other sex, the other gender that we have. And so we are here, at 1.3 billion, and I just saw the presentation she made where we're talking of 1.66 billion by 2050, when China would be 1.35 billion. So China is not going to be the most populous country. We're going to be the most populous country, and not by plan, but by the fact that we don't bother about the other set of people that exist. And then so you actually need to go through the entire snapshot to understand where we are. We have about 260 million students in the school segment at this point in time. 260 million, you know, about 135 million boys and 125 million girls. And within this, if you look at the schools, the management and boards of schools, if you look at it very carefully, here you actually have about 70% schools and only 22% is private. About 78% is actually owned by the government and the state boards and so on and so forth, which is a good thing because a country needs to invest in education. It needs to ensure that the population is equipped to actually handle and reap the dividend. But the moment you come down to the secondary education and higher education, we all fall flat. You look at the structure there again. You know, you have about 40,750 colleges, of which only 43% are public. The rest are private or private unaided, which means about 57-58% is like that. And you go towards the universities, the data is much more stark, and this slide shows you the problem. In 2010, we had 436 universities, of which 288 were public and 148 were private universities. By 2017, we have 886, which in the sense that in just 7 years, we almost doubled the number of universities that India had, because every college became a university. The public universities grew 85%, and the private grew 128%. Right? And in 2010, we had 26,000 colleges. About 9,000 were public and 17,000 private. And here, the data is very, very stark. Right? In 2014, we have 36,000 colleges, of which 10,000 in public. So the public grew from 9,000 to 10,000, but the private grew from 9,000 to 26,000. And that's where the differentiation, you know, suddenly you start seeing the delta opening up dramatically. By 2019, India would have 58,000 colleges, of which just 12,000 would be public and 46,000 would be private colleges. So you actually see a dramatic shift in terms of higher education moving into private hands. And the fact is, we must all understand and recognize, you know, all these government people will tell you that education is not for private sector, it's not for profit, and so on and so forth. The fact is that every college today is an affiliate college of a public university. And to that extent, it is, in large sense, dictated and driven by what the public university does. But having said that, it is still in private hands. And 90% of Indian education at this point in time, as far as higher education is concerned, is moving through the private hands. No harm in that. No harm in that. But the subsequent slides will exactly tell you what the problem when you actually have this mismatch that you create of talking of public education but moving it to the private hands is. You look at the innovation that India has. For a country like India, when we talk of demographic dividend and so on and so forth, we need to understand what is the innovation that we made in demography. The first time someone had said that the people of this country are human resources was Mr. P.V. Narasimha Rao. 1985 was the first time we actually had an HRD minister. Till then, we had a minister for education. Because we realized and we had acknowledged that unless we nurture our human resources, the demographic dividend is least likely to happen. And he's the first person who talked of liberalization, brought in Dr. Singh, and made HRD minister, where I think Mr. Pant was the first HRD minister. Now you look at the history of innovation that we as a country have done. And some of this might look cynical, but we must understand so that we can start dealing with the problem, and that's where I state this. The first IIT, which we claim to be one of the best innovations that India has, is 50. 1956, the first AIIMS. 1959, the first NIT. 1961, the first IIM. 1963, the first Kendriya Vidyalaya, which is one of the best private government schools that you can ever think of. And 1963, the first midday meal scheme. After 1964, which is post-Nehru, which seems to be the flavor of the day, there has not been any innovation whatsoever. The only two innovations that we had is NLUs and ISERs. Every subsequent HRD minister has created more IIMs, more IITs, more AIIMS, more Kendriya Vidyalayas, more midday meal schemes. We have stopped innovating in terms of education. We've stopped applying a mind to what we must do to nurture this demographic dividend, what we must do to nurture this huge population, which is actually burgeoning, and we need to ensure that these people are, you know, constructively employed so that we actually reap the dividend. And that is a challenge. So since the 1960s, if you look at it, no innovation, and which is where we come to now. There are 45 million students, and this is a national sample survey, NSS survey that we're talking of 18 to 24 who dropped out of education because education is unaffordable for them. Right? And I'm talking about higher education here, which means that somewhere along the line, we actually have struck the chord where they say that it's far better staying at home than going and getting yourself educated. Of the 400, and you look at the other set of data, see, the real revolution in India happened in the services sector, in the software sector, where the Infosys, the TCS, the Wipro, and all the software companies that came in started employing by the hordes. The 2008 pass-out batch of engineers was about 400,000, of which about 350,000 students were actually placed from the campuses. And these are people who entered the education stream in 2004 and passed out in 2008. The current batch which passed out, 2017, you had 1.3 million students passing out, which means we are 3.5 times of what we were in 2008. But the number of jobs that came in was 350,000 still. So the number of jobs as campus placements stayed where they were, whereas the intake output is 3.5 times of what it was. And this problem doesn't stop there. You actually have a mismatch of the kind of work that we're dealing. You have lesser medical professionals when we need more, and we have more engineers than when we need less. And this continues to happen year on year. Like this year, about 2.7 million students are going to get into engineering and pass out in 2021. And most likely, not more than 400,000 will find a job from the campus itself. So we actually have, you know, 1 in 5 being placed and 4 in 5 being unemployed. And this wouldn't be a big problem if you don't understand what exactly are the repercussions that happened. And this slide tells you. The cost of education in the last 10 years has risen dramatically. If you go back to any one of you in IIMs, if you go back to the days of 2002, 2004, the fee of IIM was 2.2 lakh rupees in 2002 to 2004 batch. Today, it's 21 lakh rupees. The fee of IIM, which is funded by the government of India, has risen by 10 times. in 14 years, and there seem to be no one answering the problem. The problem is not confined to IIMs. IIT is also the same thing. You know, you risen the fee by about 10 times. If it was just IIMs and IITs because they are the best in the class and people can afford to pay and you can have bank loans funding that, it is fine. But it actually had a ripple effect. Every private institution now charges almost closer to what IIM charges. Every private institution charges as much as what IIT would charge. Because they say, listen, you pay 15 lakhs there, why can't you pay 12 lakh rupees here? Whereas the outcome or the output isn't anywhere on par with what IIMs or IITs would do. The challenge is, as a state supply, you know, when you're a state, you're supposed to intervene or interfere into the market forces by not telling the people how much fee they charge, but by charging such good fee, or such optimal fee, that the private guys follow. You need to create 30-40% competition by giving the best education at the most optimal price so that the others also make case studies of how to give good education while making the price competitive, which is where IIMs and IITs lost the battle for all of us as citizens of India. They try to be self-sufficient to save that 100 crore rupees or to, you know, manage the books of 100 crore rupees. And what they've done is they've put on all of us, our heads, a fee structure which is unaffordable for most of us. You look at and this continues to happen. It's government after government. We're not talking of one single government. In 2018, this is the news, government stops any additional funding for the six IIMs that they've sanctioned earlier and said, take a loan and create your own buildings. Who pays for it? Ultimately, the interest also will be paid by the student. It's not going to be paid by the government at any point in time. 2017, there was a scheme to, 8,700 crores was supposed to be sanctioned for all IITs for research and scientific output. And all that was stopped because it seems they didn't comply with filing regulations or some such nonsense. In 2000, as I said, the numbers are there, 2.2 lakhs in 2002. It's 16 lakhs last year, it's 21 lakhs this year, by the way. And this ripple effect is what is causing a larger problem. And the worst thing that happened for me is, and I fought this battle on, and now it's 5%, by the way. The government started charging 18% on hostel fee, on mess charges. When did the government start thinking of charging the student for studying further? When did the government suddenly think that, here is higher education guys who are paying a lot of money, so let me also take my piece of the thing? Instead of subsidizing, here we have a government which is saying that GST is applicable, so you bloody well pay the GST. Who charges a student for studying further? You have a country which is right to education is up there. You have right to occupation, and you are actually taxing us for studying what you are supposed to provide if I don't study. So everything is a law at this point in time and nothing more than that. I'm sorry. I'll rush because, and this is the challenge. We have more youth spending more money to acquire education that may not guarantee the employment. The banks are exposed to education loans have the highest NPS at 8%. By 2030, we'll have 300 million students passing out and employable, and India should be creating 300 million jobs by each year. And that's 30 million jobs each year, I'm sorry. And India is currently losing jobs. Between 2016 and 2018, India lost 20.9 million jobs. What was 40.9 is now 38.7. And this is obviously because of the structural changes that happened in this country through demonetization and GST or whatever you call it. But the jobs have come down by 20.7 million in the last 2 years. So here we are. We are supposed to create 30 million jobs a year, and we're losing on the other side. Right. So this is the choice that I ask parents. If you as a parent were to be asked, listen, you can build a home or you have another room that you can create with your investment or invest in your child's education, what do? You typically say, first, I want to invest in my child's education. That's the option that we choose. But why do these politicians, when they act differently when they're parents, but act completely differently when they're actually administrators of the nation? That is because they want to create assets, physical assets, but don't invest in children because they're not their own children. And that becomes the problem for me. And this is something that I've read through the CAG report. See, in the earlier days, you used to have a cess called on all taxes, you used to have a 1%, 2% cess. And the total amount that was collected was 2.5 lakh crores. The primary education cess funded the midday meal scheme and the Sarva Siksha Abhiyan. So all girl children and everyone is educated now. But the secondary education cess just went into funding the government's budgetary grants for the thing. So what was the cess which was supposed to add to the budget became a part of the budget. And that is what the CAG report says. It says secondary and higher education cess was introduced in Finance Act 2007 to fulfill the commitment of secondary and higher education. Scrutiny of the Union Finance Accounts for period 2006 to 15 showed that a total collection of SHEC of 64,228 crores has been made. However, unlike the creation of PSK, which is Pradhamik Siksha Kosh, in the case of primary and elementary education says, neither a fund was designed to deposit the proceeds of SHEC, nor schemes identified on which the cess proceeds were to be spent. Consequently, the commitment of furthering secondary and higher education as envisaged in the Finance Act was not transparently ascertainable. That is the government that we're dealing with. And here are our investments. You know, if you look at India, you'll actually see the entire graph falling. The total spent by the 150,000 students who go out of India is 45,000 crores. The budget at the union government level, by the way, so this, each state also has its own budget, I'm not talking of that, is 33,000 crores. So 150,000 students, what they spend on themselves, the government of India spends a fraction of that on the entire population of this nation. And this is where we continue to work hard in terms of decelerating the growth, the investment in people. The percentage of gross national income, GNI, which was earlier 1.06% of the total income we used to spend on education, has now come down to 0.62. In the last 4 years alone, we've dropped our investment in education by about 45%, just last 4 years. So, and then you have a Bharatmala project where you want to create flyovers and bridges and whatnot. Here it is, they're about to spend 7.1 lakh crore rupees on creating a national grid of roads and whatever. A Kendri Vidyalaya, which is, for me, the best example of how a public education system would work, because KV is one place where if a parent is given an option of choosing a private education player versus Kendri Vidyalaya, he still might choose a Kendri Vidyalaya, because it's supposed to be one of the best institutions that we created in the past many years. And all the 30,000-40,000 Kendri Vidyalayas that you have are equally good in terms of creating the best minds in this country. And we spend 25,000 rupees per student as a nation on each of the KVs, right? This money would have funded 23.6 million students for the next 12 years. If we had spent the 710,000 crores back on the student, it could have, 33,000 crores is a budgeted grant. It could have funded 22 years of budgets upfront. It could have funded 700 universities or created 1,000 IITs and IIMs. But we are out because, see, my outrage is simple, that we as a nation, when we think that we need to reap demographic dividend, we need to invest in people. Are we investing in people or are we investing in physical assets that might not, give us a long-term benefit? And that's my challenge here. So this is what we should do now. Reduce the cost of education, come what may. We must create good government quality supply at an optimal cost so that the private players are in check. Create good competition and challenge private players. Learn from Delhi government. Delhi government, you look at it. People are moving from government private schools to government schools because they've done fantastic work in the way they've conducted themselves. Give tax breaks, tax-free teacher salary, tax-free investment. Anything to reduce the cost of education. Anything. To reduce the cost of education. Incentivize industry-academia collaboration. Invest in research. We want to compete with China. We invest $15 billion a year on research, and China invests $259 billion on research each year. Incentivize companies for creating jobs. Let their annual reports go. And that is what we should do. We should actually now start looking at our people as an asset and start investing in them, then just say they are the asset. Unless we do that, we actually are looking down the barrel. Thank you, guys.
My question is, so you're talking about like how jobs will be taken over in the future by AI and machine learning, but a lot of people see that as an opportunity because a lot of people think that AI will be the one operating the jobs, but actually it's going to be like a collaboration between the human and the AI. So I think that would open up a lot more jobs.
No, I hope you're true. I hope I'm wrong personally. The thing is, we need to understand one, we need to just detach ourselves from the immediate AI, ML and all and start dealing with at a macro level. At a macro level, the problem is this. When I was studying, my father used to tell me, listen, you pass class 10th very well and you'll get a job and you'll be happy. A few years later, they said class 12. A few years later, they said graduation. Now they say post-graduation. Now they say certification on top of that, right? The reason all this is happening is because there are lesser jobs and more people chasing those jobs. So we're postponing the promise that we made to a child. The promise that I make to a child today is that if you do an AI and ML qualification, you'll get a job. It might not be through 5 years down the line. That's the first piece. The second piece is that we are a country where you actually have 3 bones and 10 dogs in the same room, right? Now, when you have that, no matter what happens, 7 people are bound not to get the job. So all you're saying is one of the guys who has not got it, is you will tell him that, listen, if you do the following, you'll get the job. He'll get the job at the cost of someone else. That's my only submission. Having said that, I hope that you're true and that AI and ML will create more jobs than lose more jobs. But I have my own view on that. And future will tell us who's right in that. But I hope you're right on that.
All the conversations that you're having with the various stakeholders in government and all the places you're making this argument to, have you found people who have actually recognized the problem, and what stars need to align amongst decision makers in government and politicians and bureaucracy and thought leaders that happened when the last set of innovations in education happened? And in the meantime, when this, it sounds like we're heading towards a serious train wreck. And in the meantime, are there any other ideas being floated around about putting that in abeyance? Because there is a benefit, for example, to having people stay in school for longer, tertiary education for longer, but to other ends, or voluntary service for a year of national service or something like that. Have there been any ideas floated around on how to deal with this?
See, at a macro level, it's very difficult to find an answer because it's a long-term solution. You need to start working on it today to get a solution 20 years hence. And for the next 20 years, we're going to keep adding to this problem than reducing this problem. One of the things I personally feel, and I like the way Delhi government has worked on the primary education, you need one passionate person who's empowered and enriched and ensure that all resources are going through that person to make an impact. And it can't be done over 5 years. It should have been actually 10 years to 15 years kind of a thing. The thing that we have is that we have somehow gotten to accept that education is expensive because here is a student who's willing to pay a $50,000 to US, so why can't he pay me so and so? And that entire spiral effect is what is affecting us. For me personally, whatever we do, the first thing that we must do is to remove every governmental levy that would make education expensive, and incentivize everything that will make education slightly cheaper. There was a fantastic proposal that was promoted in 2013, but this government, when they came in, they withdrew that. And that every government does. Next time another government, if at all they come also, they'll change that. It was called it was to do with creating primary school thing. And I'll give you, PT, do I have 2 minutes? Is it okay? Can I have 2 more minutes? No. Yeah, so we're running out of time. I will sit with you, but you look at the ISB Mohali model. ISB Mohali was created when Prime Minister Manmohan Singh said that I want an ISB kind of a thing that you have in Hyderabad. The government, the state government came with the land, and 4 sponsors came in: Ranbaxy, Punj Lloyd, Airtel, and 1 more people. Each of them funded 50 crore rupees each. ISB Mohali was stood. And the same thing that 2013 proposal was trying to do in terms of schools. You get the land from the local magistrate. You invest 5 crore rupees. The government funds 30% of its students into the school system to sustain the viability of the product, and then you run it as your own school, private school. It was a model that was worth it because it brings down the cost dramatically. But it was scrapped because the new government wanted not to look at that. But you need to actually do a private-public partnerships of CSR funds to create institutions and supply to reduce the cost of education on that side. Thank you so much, guys.
I request Mr. Chandrasekharan to please award a token of thanks to Mr. Maheshwer Peri.